In the previous video, we saw how to write a very simple web client implementation in Grasshopper that we connected to the WebSocket server that we've done in the previous videos. And therefore, we were able to use, for example, the P5 sketch that we wrote that has this animated dot. We were able to use that to send coordinates in real time to our Grasshopper client. And therefore, whenever I click around here, you can see that I'm getting normalized coordinates in my Grasshopper site. Well, what we're going to do in this video is we're going to now try to use that data to replicate some geometry in Rhino, and hopefully we're going to try to animate it smoothly as well, very similar to what's happening here in P5.js. So let's take a look at how we're going to do that. The first thing we're going to do is any data that we're going to receive from the server, what we're going to do is we need to parse this data so that we can extract strategically the X and the Y values of this JSON object that we are receiving from the server. We could do this manually with some very simple string manipulation. So we could split the string in the comma, and then we could take everything between the comma and the colon, etc. But it's a little too manual for my taste, maybe or maybe not. So what I would like you to do is I'm going to be using the JSON library that is also available. Foodforrhino.com, JSON. I'm going to use the JSON library in Grasshopper, which is a library specifically for handling, serializing, and deserializing JSON information. It's by Andrew Human, who's also a very active part of the community. He's also a friend. He's extremely smart, and he has like some of the coolest plugins in Grasshopper, definitely. And also I like very much the fact that this library is open source, so you can look at the code and how it's implemented, and which is really, really cool. So thank you very much to you, Andrew, as well, for your contribution. This is really, really awesome. And so we're going to use that library to deserialize the JSON object into the X and Y components. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take deserialize, all right? And I'm going to use this component to plug in what we receive from the server. And you see how the component mutates itself to give me these two outputs, X and Y. All right. This is great, but it's great from a user interface point of view, but for stable applications that need to be able to handle bad information, it's not great, because if I send something else, something that is not a JSON file. So I'm going to, for example, send this information. You see that I start getting errors here. This is not a JSON file. Or if somebody sent a JSON with a different format, this will mutate and all the wires that were connected here will disconnect right away. So for this kind of applications where I can't be sure about the structure of the JSON data, I actually like to use this other component better, which is a component that directly says, give me the JSON object, and now tell me which property is the one that you want to read from that JSON object. And if there is such property, well, you see, this is not working because I don't have a JSON. So let me just send some JSON data, okay? So if there is such a value, it will be output here. So the key is going to be that, and the value is going to be this one. You see, so this is the X value, and every time I click here, you see, I am reading the X value of this circle. Similarly, I'm going to do the same thing for the Y value, okay? And if at any time this information doesn't have XY properties, this will just be empty. So now I can read the X and Y properties of this circle. So what I can do now is I can just turn this into a point, for example. I'm going to construct point. I'm going to construct point here. These are going to be the X coordinate and the Y coordinate. And I'm going to use that as the center of a circle that is going to be somewhere there. And the radius is going to be very small because of the size. So I'm going to do something like this, for example. And I think with this, what we will be able to notice is that If in Rhino, oh, sorry, in, let me dock my windows correctly. In Rhino, if I go to the top view now, if I go to the top view, you can see that I have a tiny circle. Maybe this was too small. Okay, I have a tiny circle that is going to be moving in the X and Y. And for example, if I go here, you can see that the motion of my circle is corresponding, is being read by Rhino, and then the circle is moving in X and Y according to those coordinates. Now, one thing we need to keep in mind is the coordinate space of P5 is X positive in this direction, just like in Rhino is, but Y is positive going down, as opposed to Y being positive in Rhino space going up. So one thing we need to do in order to make things more coherent is that we need to flip the orientation of the Y direction in Grasshopper so that it matches the orientation of the canvas in P5.js. So basically I can negate, I can say, no, sorry, this is not negate. I can say, I need to take the value of Y, and from the value of Y, I need to subtract whatever I am getting in from the outside. Oh yeah, sorry, the error that I were facing is, you see the expression thinks that Y is a Boolean, so they cannot subtract Y to the number one. And it thinks so because the output of this component is actually a generic value. So it is right now something that looks like a number, but Grasshopper cannot really tell that it is a number. So the way we can just work around this is by forcefully turning it into a number by using the parameter, by using one of the parameter components, just this. So it just, by passing data through there, the data gets basically casted, it gets forced into a number, and then we can now subtract that for the number one, and then this is, these are the coordinates that we want here for our circle. So we can do that, and then we can see how, for example, the editor, if we start this again, now we can see how as we go down to the corner, it approaches this corner. Now it's all the way down in almost 0, 1. Now it's all the way in the other corner. We're working on the 0, 1 space here. And you can see how the shapes are basically, and they're basically coordinated, right? Now, this is great, but this circle is kind of boring because it's just, I click here and it goes there right away. I click here and it goes there right away. It's not as nice as we have here with the animation. So I wonder if there is anything we can do to animate this circle here. And the way we can do that is by writing a C# component that we constantly update and then we use to do this smooth animation also here in Grasshopper. Because why not? I mean, since we're here already. So let's try doing that. So what we're going to do is I'm going to open here. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this point and I'm going to take the radius. And then I'm going to take this, I'm going to follow the same logic as I have followed in the previous exercise with processing in P5, where I'm going to treat this point as where I want the circle to go to. And then I'm going to, every frame in Grasshopper, periodically, I'm going to change that value incrementally with this motion that we described before called easing. The way I'm going to do that is by creating a C# component here. Here I'm going to call the input, I'm going to call it the target, so where do I want to go, and this is going to be of the type 0.3D, for example. I'm going to add here another value called the easing. This is going to be of the type double, which you can see it just flew onto my other screen, and this is going to be, for example, the value of 0.05. all right, so that's going to define how smooth the motion is going to be. And the radius of the circle that this component is going to produce is going to be this slider here, which is going to be of the type double. The output is going to be this circle that is going to be animated and eased over over the animations. So how does this work? What we're going to do is we're going to open the sketch here. Data tree easing. I don't want a data tree for the easing. I don't know where that happens. So item access, yes. So I'm going to open that. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to here, outside of the main function, I'm going to define two variables. I'm going to define a variable 0.3D, which is current position. And I'm going to define 0.3D, which is going to be target. And let me actually just write post and target as I did. And I'm going to change the name of this as data, for example, data points, so that I don't have confusions between the target that is coming in from the function and the one that we have as a value. So here I'm going to store these two variables here because this data is going to be persistent. It's going to not be erased by new instances of the C# script component running over and over again. I have examples of why this is convenient in other previous videos. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to say every time that I get a new data point, what I'm going to do is I'm going to set the target to be to that data point. All right, so whenever I get new data, I want the target to be that one. And then every frame, what I'm going to do is I'm going to smooth the position towards the target. So I'm going to do that by saying position X needs to be incremented by the value of easing times where this ball wants to go minus where the ball is right now. This is the same code that we wrote basically on the other examples. And for position Y, I also want to make it go from whatever it was, whatever it has to go, minus whatever it is right now. All of this multiplied by a factor that makes the motion a little slower. All right. And then every frame, what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a new circle C on top of that point. So the radius is going to be radius, and then the plane, I need to type the center here first, so position and radius. All right. And the circle, the output, is going to be that new circle that I just created. As I do this, this is already working. You can see that the point is here. And if I change data, you can see that nothing really changes here on my sketch. Might be also because I might be disconnected. Am I disconnected? Yes, I am disconnected. So let me connect again. And I am going to now, you see, I'm changing the location here, and the ball tries to approximate, but only does once. It does only once whenever new data is received. What we need to do is we need to make sure that this component is trying to recalculate the position of the circle very often. And the way we're going to do that is by just adding a trigger here, which is going to be poking the component like at intervals. For example, every 50 milliseconds, I'm asking you to perform calculations. You see? So, and then I'm going to make this a little faster, 20 milliseconds. Every 20 milliseconds, I'm forcing this component to recompute. And if I give it new data, so for example, here, then the circle starts smoothing. You say, whoa, you. And you can see how the point is telling us where the circle is going to go. And the circle is following in the same way as all the animations of the other clients. So, yoo-hoo! So we were basically able to create, to control the position of geometry and to animate the location of that geometry by using an external application connected via WebSockets to our Grasshopper definition. Choo, choo, choo! How cool is that, huh? All right, wonderful. So let's keep playing a little bit with that. So in the next video, what I want to do is I want to write a version of this, where instead of just a simple circle in XY space, I would like to use this logic to drive the motion of a sphere on an actual nerve's surface. So we're going to make the sphere navigate across the geometry of a nerve surface, which is going to be super cool. And we're going to connect that to all of this. So if you're liking this so far, consider liking this video, subscribing, notifications, and all that stuff. Otherwise, see you on the next video in this series of Fun with WebSockets.